Welcome. This is a video about spirituality and the mystical experience. The hope is to give you a general introduction and the possibility of exploring various spiritual paths which are open to the general public. Enlightenment or illumination are generic terms for the phenomena used loosely to describe the state of mystical attainment, regardless of faith. Differing religious traditions describe this fundamental experience in many different ways. The usual terms are mysticism, which refers to beliefs and practices that go beyond the liturgical and devotional forms of worship of mainstream faith, often by seeking out inner or esoteric meanings of conventional religious doctrine, and by engaging in spiritual practices such as breathing, prayer, contemplation, and meditation, along with chanting and other activities designed to heighten spiritual awareness. Mystics hold that there is a deeper or more fundamental state of existence beneath the observable day-to-day world of phenomena, and that in fact the ordinary world is superficial. Mysticism, therefore, is the pursuit of communion with, identity with, or conscious awareness of an ultimate reality, divinity, spiritual truth, or God through direct experience, intuition, instinct, or insight. Mysticism usually centers on a practice or practices intended to nurture those experiences or awareness. Mysticism may maintain a distinction between the self and the divine, or it may be non-dualistic. Mystical traditions usually form a subcurrent within larger religious traditions, such as Kabbalah within Judaism, Sufism within Islam, Vedanta within Hinduism, and Gnosticism within Christianity. For example, Kabbalah in Judaism seeks out deeper interpretations of Torah and other mystical works. It may conduct spiritual practices based on meditation, theurgy, or alchemy, as well as song, dance, prayer, and Talmudic studies, as is done in many other mystical traditions. Sufism in Islam extends and amplifies the teachings of the Quran in the spirit of universal love, most famously through their devotional musicians, dancing zikrs, and singing adwalis. Vedanta in Hinduism reaches for the inner teachings of Hindu philosophy in the Vedas, and will use the symbolism and mythologies of their gods and goddesses to take the initiate home to their highest awarenesses via mystical practices designed and proven for these purposes. But each of these are often treated skeptically and sometimes held separately by more orthodox or mainstream groups within the given religions, due to the emphasis of the mystics on direct experience and living realizations over doctrine. Mysticism is sometimes taken by skeptics or mainstream adherents as mere obfuscation, though mystics suggest they are offering a clarity of a different order or kind. In fact, a basic premise of nearly every mystical path, regardless of religious affiliation, is that the experience of divine consciousness, enlightenment, and union with God that are made possible via mystical paths are available to everyone who is willing to follow the practices of a given mystical system. Within a given mystical school or path, it is much more likely for the mystical approach to be seen as a divine science because of the direct replical elevation of consciousness the mystical approach can offer to anyone, regardless of previous spiritual or religious training. Mystical traditions tend to be more accepting of other mystical traditions than the non-mystical version of their traditions. This is based on the premise that the experienced divinity is able to bring other mystics to their own traditions if necessary. Because mysticism focuses on direct realization, this obviates many concerns about the afterlife, and this often conflicts with conventional religious doctrines. As a rule, mystics are less concerned with religious differences and more concerned with social or individual development. What mysticism is most concerned with, however, is having the most efficient set of practices to attain enlightened consciousness and union with God. Not much else beyond this matters to a dedicated mystic who focuses on the inner realms, mind breath, no thinking awareness, and so on. Mystics are not too concerned with the opinions or religious tools of their more conservative religious compatriots. Therefore, different faiths have different relationships to mystical thought. Hinduism has many mystical sects, in part due to its historic reliance on gurus for transmission of its philosophy. Mysticism in Buddhism is largely monastic, since most Buddhists consider meditation to be an advanced technique used only after many lifetimes. Many followers of Abrahamic faiths, particularly Christianity and Islam, have criticized much of mysticism or esotericism, calling it black magic. Religions such as Christianity and Islam have very contrasting views due to its linear time view of a single life and a heaven or a hell afterlife, as opposed to cyclical time and reincarnation. Evelyn Underhill outlines the process by which the mystic arrives at a union with the Absolute. She identifies 5 stages of this process. First is the awakening. One begins to have some consciousness of divine reality. The second stage is a purgation, characterized by an awareness of one's own imperfections and finiteness. The third stage, illumination, is marked by a consciousness of a transcendent order and a vision of a new heaven and a new earth. The great mystics go beyond the stage of illumination to the fourth stage, which is the dark night of the soul. This stage, experienced by the few, is one of final and complete purification and is marked by confusion, helplessness, stagnation of the will, and a sense of the withdrawal of God's presence. This is the period of final unselfing and the surrender to the hidden purposes of the divine will. The final and last stage is one of union with the object of love, the one reality, God. Here the self has been permanently established on a transcendent level and liberated for a new purpose. Filled with the divine will, it immerses itself in the world in order to become a mediator between humanity and eternity. Mysticism is generally considered experiential and holistic, and mystical experiences held to be beyond expression. Modern philosophy, psychology, biology, and physics sometimes being seen as overly analytical, verbal, and reductionist. However, in some instances throughout history, mystical and philosophical thought were closely entwined. Empedocles, Parmenides, Plato, and Pythagoras, and to a lesser extent Socrates, had elements in their teachings that could be interpreted as mystical in nature. Many of the great Christian mystics were also prominent philosophers. And some Buddhist sutras and fundamental texts in Buddhism and Hinduism display what seems to be analytical elements of mystical ideas. The emphasis that is placed on subjective, direct experience of the divine and otherworldly transcends goals of unity, which makes it controversial to individuals who place a greater emphasis on empirical verification of knowledge and truth, such as scientists, for example. Enlightenment comes from becoming aware of the nature of the self through observation. By examination of the interior thought system and emotions with detachment, one becomes aware of its processes without being controlled by them, allowing one greater creative capacity and the ease of interaction with others and the environment. When the mind is no longer a subject, it is starting to become an object in the observation of itself. And so the mystical, contemplative, and yogic traditions pick up where the mind leaves off, with the observing self as it begins to transcend the mind. The contemplative traditions are based upon a series of experiments in awareness. What if you pursue this witness to its source? What if you inquire within, pushing deeper and deeper into the source of awareness itself? What do you find then? Regardless of particular concepts of the what is occurring, a good thread of mysticism is the experience of a collective peace, joy, compassion, or love. But again, the mystic's disregard of religious institutional structures often lends a quasi-revolutionary aspect to mystical teachings, and this occasionally leads to conflict with established religious and political structures, or the creation of splinter groups or new faiths. Separately, the relation of mysticism to ethics and morality is more complex than usually assumed. Mystical experiences do not guarantee that a mystic will be compassionate or moral. Nor, on the other hand, is a mystical state incompatible with being morally concerned with others. Rather, a given mystic's ethics will depend on the factual belief and values espoused in that mystic's religious or personal traditions. Who are the mystics of recent time? The late 19th century saw a significant increase of interest in mysticism in the West, combined with increasing interest in occultism and Eastern philosophy. Theosophy became a major movement in the popularization of these interests. Madame Blavatsky functioned as a central figure of the theosophical movement. This trend later became absorbed in the rise of the New Age movement, which included a major surge in the popularity of psychological self-awareness groups. At the end of the 20th century, books like A Course in Miracles, purported to be a channeled course of study dictated by Jesus, and Conversations with God, in which the author describes his direct communication with God, became popularized. In the early 17th century, esotericism is represented by currents such as Christian theosophy and Rosicrucianism. A century later, esoteric ideas entered various strands of Freemasonry. The Rosicrucian Order is a legendary and secretive order publicly documented in the early part of the 17th century. Rosicrucianism is a philosophical secret society said to have been founded in the late medieval Germany by Christian Rosencrantz. It holds the doctrine or theology built on esoteric truths of the ancient past, which, concealed from the average man, provide insight into nature, the physical universe, and the spiritual realm. Rosicrucianism is symbolized by the Rosy Cross. The Rosicrucian order is viewed by earlier and many modern Rosicrucians as an inner world order composed of great adepts. When compared to human beings, the consciousness of these adepts is said to be like that of demigods. This college of invisibles is regarded as the source permanently behind the development of the Rosicrucian movement. The fellowship seeks to prepare the individual through harmonious development of mind and heart in a spirit of unselfish service to mankind and an all-embracing altruism. Their mission is to prepare the whole wide world for a new phase in religion, which includes awareness of the interworlds and the subtle bodies, and to provide safe guidance in the gradual awakening of man's latent spiritual faculties during the next six centuries towards the coming of the Age of Aquarius. Freemasonry is a worldwide fraternal organization. Members are said to be joined together by shared ideals of both a moral and metaphysical nature, by a belief in a supreme being. Freemasonry is an esoteric society, in that certain aspects of its internal works are not disclosed to the public, but they claim that it is not an occult system. The private aspects of modern Freemasonry deal with elements of ritual and the modes of recognition amongst members within the ritual. Mysticism and Buddhism has that Buddhism includes a vast array of scriptures, beliefs, traditions, and practices. Many of these are not overly mystical, yet some doctrines have a strong flavor of mysticism. Preeminent among these are the teachings of the Dzogchen and of the Buddha nature living mostly unrecognized in all of us. Both of these doctrines indicates the presence of a hidden, deathless core reality within each being, which needs to be recognized and entered into. Numerology. Some numerologies include belief in a mystical relationship between numbers and the physical objects or living things, or in numbers representing relationships between them that are not scientifically based. In traditional Chinese medicine, the location of the points used to place needles in acupuncture is based on the number of days in the year, the number of major rivers in the Chinese Empire at the time of development, and similar considerations. Pythagoras believed that the relationship between numbers and music had a supernatural basis. Again, the major exponent of esotericism in the latter part of the 19th century is the theosophy of Madame Blavatsky. Theosophy is also considered a major influence on the many less institutionally organized varieties of esotericism in metaphysical milieus, such as ascended masters' activities within the New Age. In the 20th century, theosophy was reformulated by Annie Besant, Charles Leadbetter, Alice Bailey, Rudolf Steiner, and many others, and became a source for a range of post-theosophical movements. A particularly successful post-theosophical movement is anthroposophy, a synthesis of occultist, Christian, and Neoplatonic ideas with Western esoteric concepts as formulated in the wake of theosophy. Anthroposophy, which was founded by Rudolf Steiner in the early part of the 20th century, includes esoteric versions of education, agriculture, and medicine. Finally, it can be noted that Carl Gustav Jung can be seen as an exponent of esotericism. His writings concern esoteric subject matters such as alchemy and rephrased the concept of modern correspondences in a modern psychologicalized terminology in his theory of synchronicity. We have provided for you additional definitions of the various possible schools you may wish to examine for your further studies, and hope that you can use this and the websites that are listed for your further pursuit of detailed knowledge of this subject. Thank you.